search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Melt empty praise and treasures of fame are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together.
Good morning, church family. How we doing? Good morning, online family. How we doing? Woo, sounding good, sounding good. Man, we are excited. Are you excited to be here this morning? Yes, we are excited, excited. We're expectant. And I hope you're expectant too. We got a couple of new songs, a couple of classics, Christmas classics, and then some good ones. So, are we ready to worship this morning? All right, let's do it.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah, oh, louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. A hallelujah. Oh, heaven comes to fight for me.
So open up the windows, let the light in.
Open up the windows, let the light in.
Open up the windows, let the light in. Let the light in.
Come on.
Let the light in.
Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Open up the
light in. Let the light in.
Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in.
Let the light in. Let the light in. Open up the windows, let the light in.
Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Let the light in.
Let the light in.
Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Open up the windows,
let the light in.
Let the light in.
Let the light in.
Fling wide you the heavenly gates.
Let the King of Glory.
God, we thank you for this morning, Lord. We thank you for the hope that we have in Jesus. We thank you for this season. And God, for a lot of us, it's just, it's our favorite time. I know for me, it's my favorite time, God. And for a lot of us, it's hard, Lord. And we know that there are people out there who are hurting, and these are tough times. They've lost loved ones, God. But we ask that you just walk through them in this time. Lord, help us to be there for them, to help them walk through, God. Help us to be joyful and expectant, like so long ago when they were expectant for you, God. We just, we love you, we give you thanks, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. We got a new song this morning. It's called Hope Has a Name. And we know what that name is. It's Jesus.
Through the silence, with glory in the highest, the hope of all creation, risen in his mother's arms. The song on the horizon, ringing through the heavens, the long-awaited Savior, set the captives free. Oh, come to set the captives free. Come to set us free.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, hope has a name. Emmanuel, the light of the world, who broke through the darkness. Thank you.
you're broken, and come if you're searching. Yeah, if you need healing, oh, he's where you find him. And lay down your burdens, oh, and breathe in forgiveness. And if you need freedom, yeah, he's where you find him. Oh, if you need freedom, yeah, he's where you find him. Yeah, he's where you find him. Oh, hope has a name, Emmanuel, the light of the world, who broke through the darkness. Oh, hail the King, Emmanuel, the light of the world, the glory of heaven. Hope has a name, Emmanuel, the light of the world, who broke through my darkness. Oh, hail the King, Emmanuel, the light of the world, the glory of heaven.
Good morning. Let's take this mask off. All right. Matthew 1, 20 through 21 reads like this. Says, but as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful and mindful of this holiday season. Father, that not to be wrapped up in the gatherings or the presents or the decorations, though all of these things are fine, but Father, that we are humbled, realizing the reason for this season and what we are being mindful of is that Christmas narrative, Father, and the way that it is told through Scripture. Father, that you took impossible means and made them possible. Because God, it's just like you to take something that we look right over as ordinary, but for you to use them within your purpose and for your will and for your glory. And Father, we are so thankful to be here this morning, knowing that we are also a part of that perfect plan that you have put into place. Father, we are thankful and humble just to be a part and to be able to meet here in his name this morning. Father, at the right time, at the appointed time, that your son, Jesus, would be born and that he would grow up and have a sinless life and a wonderful ministry, all to reveal more of your plan to us, that he would then have to go and die on a cross, but taking the punishment that we deserved. So, Father, we are just so thankful for this moment in history that we get to look back and celebrate, to know that the sin problem, that you had an answer for it, an answer that you had promised. And it just shows that you do not lie and you do not back out on your promises. And when you plan something, Father, that it happens. So as we look at peace this morning and continue to look at peace next Sunday, I pray that we would remember, Father, I pray that you would put that on our minds and our hearts, that we would humble ourselves and just rely on you. Father, the world is so chaotic and there's so much to look at in dread, but Father, you provide even more that we can hold on to in peace. Not peace in our circumstances, but peace in the heart. So Father, I pray that this morning you would remove all distractions. Father, remove all personal preferences and opinions, and let us just focus on your truth and your word this morning. I pray that as Jerry preaches this morning, that we would see you in a new light, to love you more, to trust you more. Father, to seek you for our peace. So Father, I pray, and I'm glad, and we are thankful for this season. I pray that you would keep us mindful and humble in it. Father, let us be encouraged and spurred on to go share this with the rest of the world that is an obvious need and has obvious lack of peace and purpose and hope. Father, you have called us to this ministry. So Father, in this time, as we rest in that peace, encourage us to go and share that peace with others. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, good morning. I'm glad that you're here to worship with us this morning, and all of you at home, I'm glad that you have chosen to, one, wake up early enough to join the stream, and for those of you that are watching after it is streamed, I am also thankful that you were here, but you might need to do better. Come on now. All right. I'm kidding. Just playing. I do have some announcements this morning. One, the ladies' banquet, I hear, went well. Didn't go, not a lady, but heard it was wonderful. And it looked beautiful, the pictures. I've never been to Matthew's Manor, but I got to go with Jamie and a few of our other church members to go and set up, and I was impressed. That was a really beautiful venue, so I'm really glad we were able to use that. It's such a blessing. So I hear that went well, but our Christmas announcements are not over. We had our ladies' banquet. It went well, but we've also got our Christmas Eve services coming up. COVID willing, those will go just as planned. We have one at 5 o'clock, and then we have one at 6:15. So if you're unable to make the first one or the second one, we encourage you and would love to have you to come and sing carols and to go through the Christmas narrative with us on that day. That is, Christmas Eve services, so that would be December 24th. On December 20th, we are going to be doing our Christmas offering, so be prepared to give that day for our Christmas offering. We'll be dividing that up. Some will go to Alabama Teen Challenge. Some of it will go to the missionary couple that we had come by, going to Scotland. That's the Hidalgo family. And then we're also donating some money and being able to help Zach and Elizabeth out up in Maine as they are kind of revitalizing that church and doing their ministry up there. I'm really glad that we're able to be involved with them still to help them out. We are also selling pecans. We've got a few more bags left, a bunch of bags of chopped pecans. It's $13 a bag. That money will go to help us go to Strength to Stand this year and pay for some of our students to be able to go on that trip. If you have a student that is desiring to go on that trip with us, we would love for them to go. And I ask that you don't. It is $130 per student. If that's something that you can't make right now, I realize that we're in the holiday seasons. I get that money's tight already anyways with COVID and everything else. But don't let money be the reason that your child or your student doesn't get to go on this trip with us. We have members in this church that would love to be able to pay their way for them to go. It is more important for us that we're able to go and go to this conference and worship together and grow closer, not just as a group, but grow closer as a group in Christ. So that is far more important to us. So don't let money be the reason that your teenager or your student or friend is not able to go. So be willing to offer that to anybody that's interested. And with that, I will hand it over to our Pastor Jerry.
You guys enjoy Ryan preaching last week. Last two Sundays, that was his first time to ever preach here at Argo Christian Fellowship. And from what I saw online, he did a great job. And I appreciate him so much being willing to do that. And Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. What we're going to do in addition to the Christmas offering next Sunday, the Sunday before Christmas, is traditionally what we take and divide up among those missions things. But we're also going to do something local with some healthcare people, some nurses. We want to surprise them with some gift certificates. So if you'd like to give towards that, we're going to then give those gift certificates to some of our nurses, and they can surprise some of their coworkers with those. And Lord willing, if we have enough, we'd like to go into some of our schools and take it to the nurses in the schools. So that would be cool. That would include Margaret Elementary and Springville, those three schools. And Clay, if we can get enough to go in there, and even Trustville, if we have enough, it'd be a great thing to do. So be thinking about that. Also, if you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 1. We are going to be looking at the Christmas story, and we know that the Christmas story is found in two of the four Gospels in very, very simple terms. It's also found in John, but a little bit more, not quite as clear cut as it is in Matthew and Luke. But this morning, we're going to look at a few verses from the book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew. I know your Christmas decorations are up. How many of you went all out this year for Christmas decorations? Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. I have yet to put our outside Christmas lights up, and it could take me maybe 10, 15 minutes. Just running the extension cords is what really, because I bought those plug-in deals, and they just shine all those dots on your house. It's a whole lot of bling for not much effort, and I really like that. The family was kind of making fun of me. What's Daddy had not had time to put up the Christmas lights outside yet? But the Christmas decorations are up, and my favorite part of our Christmas decorations, other than the fact that Sandy puts them all up, but I love the nativity scenes, the creches. We have one on our buffet that is my favorite. I don't know how many piece set it is, probably a 30 or 40 piece set. But it was made for us by a lady in San Antonio, Texas, at our first church in San Antonio. She did it out of ceramic, and it's just a lot of meaning. So we've had it these 34 years. I can't believe it. And we put it out every year. So we put it out every year. And by that, you know, I mean Sandy puts it out every year. But then a few years ago, Sandy also bought a concrete creche, and it's on the front porch. And these are 12 to 14 inch high statues, and they're really, really heavy. And at first I was kind of a little skeptical on it. She got it after Christmas sale. And but I really enjoy seeing those out there. It's really cool. So, you know, those scenes are always so peaceful. You know, they're always so quiet sitting there. When you set up the nativity scene, you know, you've got the little animals that you put there, and everybody is just staring intently and softly at the baby who's sleeping very, very peacefully. But even though those decorations are peaceful, we know that it is depicting a scene that was not peaceful. at all. In reality, it was absolute chaos. We know that there was a census that had to be taken, so Mary had to leave her hometown, as with everybody else, and go into the city of their birth. And so they had to travel, and there were doubts about this baby that she had, and the trust, and even some fear there among them. She's with someone that she's espoused to, she's engaged to, and all of this, you can imagine all of this going on. On top of it all, not too long after this, Herod the Great heard about the birth of Jesus Christ, and he was fearful for his position, and so he wanted to kill all the firstborn of the Jews, and he did. And so there was this incredible scene taking place. So it was absolute turmoil, even though our little nativity scenes don't depict that. And I think even in the heart of Matthew, you think about a man who was engaged, and then you find out that the woman that you're engaged to is pregnant. And she tells you a story that it was by the Holy Spirit. And you can imagine, as men, what you would think, that your fiance has been unfaithful, and now she's trying to pawn this off on God. A miracle of God has done this. You would not believe it. And yet Joseph, we're going to see here, we get privy to a little bit of a scene where the archangel Gabriel then is dispatched to go to Joseph in a dream and explain to him that this is true. This is exactly what happened. And it wasn't by accident, it was planned. This is the way it has to be. So we begin reading in verse 18 of chapter 1. It says this: "Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet: 'Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which means 'God with us.' When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus." Here we have the incarnation of Jesus Christ, God becoming man through the conception of the Holy Spirit, conceived by the Holy Spirit to Mary. And the incarnation of Jesus Christ is the central fact of Christianity. It is a central fact of our faith. Without it, everything about our faith and everything that we believe is really in vain, because it would mean that Jesus Christ was not God and did not come to earth. Mary conceived by God, a virgin birth, Jesus being both divine, God, and also man, 100% both. If this was not true, then the gospel is not true, and the gospel is not there for us. There are some vital aspects of Jesus's divinity. When you think about theology, there is the virgin birth. These are the big ones. These are the crown jewels of our Jesus's divinity and of our theology: his virgin birth, his substitutionary atoning death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his return. If any of these can be proven as false or as a lie, then the whole thing crumbles. And if the whole thing crumbles, or one of these things is not true, then our salvation is not there, and it crumbles. It is gone. So without these facts, and we know that by faith we believe in the virgin birth and the substitutionary atoning death on the cross, and then of Jesus' resurrection and his ascension, and then we believe by faith that he will return again, his return. So we see these absolute essential facts of Jesus Christ's deity. They're essential to us. They're very personal to us as followers of Jesus Christ, as believers. And without them, we would have no peace. And we know that Christmas time is a time of peace. We may not think about it. We may not always have it at the forefront. But in this Sunday morning and next week even and last week, Ryan bringing us thoughts about peace. I want us to go into this Christmas season with peace because we're living in a season where there is no peace. And we're not like some countries where there is so much war and things going on. Our wars are fought much more. I mean, we see so much unrest and harm going on. But there's just a subtlety to our war that is taking place among the. And the reason is because people have no peace. People are not at peace. The Bible tells about peace. The two main ones we know, peace with God, that is salvation. What before Christ, before forgiveness and repentance, that we are enemies of God. And so when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and you repent, then you have peace with God. You have peace with God through Jesus Christ, His Son. And then there is the peace of God. This is for believers, for those of us going through turmoil and heartache and pain and loss. And then we have that peace of God that God brings us. So those are the two main aspects of peace in the Scripture that we're told that we have as believers. But then there's also, we know that there is peace with others. And this is peace with relationships, peace with our spouse, our children, our neighbors, peace with our government, peace with people at work. And there is those relationship peace. And then there is the peace among nations. It's been interesting to see all of the peace deals being brokered in the Middle East with Israel and all of these things going on. And this is very interesting to watch from a biblical worldview perspective. But we know that for the most part, peace among nations, it means that one nation is able to destroy you. So, of course, you're going to be at peace with them. That's why America has enjoyed so much peace, because no one wants to mess with us. We're too powerful of a nation for the most part. So we've not been messed with. But peace among nations would be the absence of war. And we know that these continue and there are wars going on. I think it's been great these last few years of our nation where we're bringing troops home and we're ceasing these endless wars that we seem to be in. But peace is something that is important to us in our everyday lives because we desire it, we want it. And at Christmas time, I want us to think about peace, even though we should be celebrating it every day, thinking about it every day. But at Christmas time, we really need to be thinking about that, what it means with Jesus Christ coming to live here and being born and the peace that it brings. But how can we show peace? How can I show peace? How can you show peace? How can we show peace? It is with our families. It is with our families. That's how we model God's peace to us. We know that the family is the first church. The family was the first church. God instituted the family before He instituted the church. At Christmas time, we think about family. We went to Kansas for Thanksgiving. There we celebrate Thanksgiving. We celebrate a little bit of Christmas with my brothers and sisters and their kids. And there was only about 30 or 40 of us. I forget how many. We couldn't go to the hall. They've closed down things in Kansas even more. And so we went to my sister's house. And if there's any law enforcement officials in Kansas that want to know her address, you can call me and I'll give you that, because it was her idea and not mine. I would have obeyed the law. But they would have seen those Alabama out-of-state tags, and you didn't quarantine for 14 days, and you didn't do this or that and the other. But we think about family at Christmas time, and we should, extended family. But what about our immediate family? What about our family, what we have control of? We see in this scene, we see Mary's courage, and the courage that it took for a young girl, conceived of her by the Holy Spirit, her courage to go forward and to carry out God's purpose for her life. And we see Joseph's obedience there with the revelation from the angel of what all this was meaning and what all that God was doing and how it was being fulfilled through his life and through his decisions. Then we see the baby Jesus, the swaddling clothes. We see this little baby, this young family coming together. And we think about our family. It should remind us of our own family, and that the peace that this baby brought is the same peace that we can show with our individual family. God created the family for a purpose. And I guess the question is, what is God's purpose for my family? What is God's purpose for your family? I hope and pray that my kids learn to be able to be at peace. To be at peace with God, first of all, but to be at peace with themselves and to be at peace with others. Because that goes such a long way. As the family is healthy, so is the community, the state, and the nation. When you break down the family, unrest is the result. You see all kinds of turmoil that spills out of these broken homes into other homes and into schools and into jobs. And we see all of these failing. We see an increase in police presence is needed and all kinds of civil disobedience and rebellion and various kinds of self-destruction with addictions that come in when the family breaks down. That's why there is such an attack on the family, because God designed it with such an incredible purpose to show forth God's love and God's plan for mankind with a mother and a father and the children. So you see this in areas of the country, and even here in Alabama, you see it in certain cities where you don't go those places by yourself, or you don't go at certain times of the day because it's not safe. And that is all a result, a direct result, of the breakdown of the family. Well, the angel of the Lord said this: "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. So our families, this is what we show forth. This is what we depict, that we have God with us, that we have Emmanuel with us, God with us. Jesus' birth means God with us. God's presence is the remedy for mankind. If we know Him, we know peace. If we have no God, then we have no peace. If we do not know Him, we have no peace. The world's peace is temporary, but God's peace is eternal, and that is through Jesus Christ. One thing that the Messiah did was He fulfilled an unexpected role. That's what Messiah did. His prophecy, the prophecy of Him coming, was foretold for generations and generations. The Israelites didn't know all of the details of the birth of Messiah, but they knew that it was out there, that it was going to come, this promised Messiah. And sadly, the nation of Israel is still looking for Messiah. It's like they were looking at mountaintops in the distance. They knew that the Messiah was coming and what He was going to do and what He was going to fulfill, that He was going to come from God, but they couldn't see into the valleys and into the trees and everything that was going to transpire and exactly how God was going to do this. In fact, that verse that we read there, Matthew 1:23, is also Isaiah 7:14, told 1,000 years or more before the birth of Jesus Christ. The prophet foretold that verse, and it's repeated here in Matthew, saying this is exactly what was foretold. So the Messiah coming, He fulfilled the expected role. His coming was foretold. He would deliver Israel. He would deliver all mankind from their sin. Through Him would come salvation and deliverance. What man couldn't do through obedience of the law, what Israel couldn't do through obedience of the law, God fulfilled through Jesus Christ. So Messiah had a role to fill, and that role was salvation for mankind. So Jesus fulfilled the expected. He bridged the gap between God and man. He did what no one else could. He provided forgiveness. He lived as a man and He died as God. The expected role. That was something that everyone anticipated, and when He came and He fulfilled that, those that recognized it, us that recognize it, we can see that it is expected of Him. But Jesus Christ did so much more than that with His coming, with His presence. He did the unexpected. He left heaven. That's something I think about occasionally. Why in the world, how in the world could God leave heaven? How could He empty Himself and take upon Himself the form of a servant? He could have lived for Himself. He could have forgotten mankind. He could have done it in a way where He could bring heaven with Him, the trappings of His position, and He could bring all the regalness of His place, of His dwelling with Him, and fulfill this role in some other way, and yet He didn't. He abandoned all that. He abandoned all that. I'm not sure what was worse, God leaving heaven or God dying on a cross, but they're both very, very impactful. Because He did the unexpected. And then how did He come? Did He come as a conquering hero on a horse with an army of angels, with Gabriel at his side, with Michael at his side, the archangels? Did he come in that way with an incredible force as a great show of light and power and majesty? No, he came as a baby. He did the unexpected. He came as a baby. He was born into a family. He was born to a young girl, a virgin, not with royal surroundings, but humble surroundings, in the lowliest of towns that there was in that area, Bethlehem. And then he also did the unexpected, that when he left this earth, he said, I'm going to give you now another form of me, and it's called the Holy Spirit. Not just God with us, God here on earth, but I'm going to come and live within you through the Holy Spirit. So you're going to have guidance, and you're going to have comfort and discernment. And even when you go through such difficult times, I will be able to pray for you and intercede to the Father for you, and I will pray for you and help you. But he also then gave us his word, and the things that he lived and the things that he did and the story of God then being recorded throughout the centuries for us to be able to have in the form of the Bible, for us to read it. I mean, it's something totally unexpected and something you would not think possible that could happen, except God did it. It was unexpected. We can read it and memorize it. We can find comfort. We can study it. We can know God. We can sit down with our families and read the scriptures and read the stories and be reminded of God's faithfulness and his love and how much he cares for us. Peace is not an idea or a state of being. Peace is a person, and we know that person is Jesus Christ. He did the expected, and he also did the unexpected. So here's my thoughts for this morning. This Christmas, let's be reminded of these two things for our own families. There is so much that is out of control in our own lives and in our world today, but one thing we can control is our families. One thing that we can have influence over is our own families. We can model Jesus Christ to our family, the presence of Jesus Christ. Because they desperately need it, and so does this world. So, following Jesus' example, this Christmas, we can do the expected. We can do the expected. We can fulfill our obligations. My kids would be devastated if they woke up on Sunday Christmas morning and there were no presents under the tree. That would just be a horrible thing to do, wouldn't it? That would just be horrible. I mean, they expect that. They expect that. But we can fulfill our obligations to our children. And we think about not just the Christmas time, but how we fulfill our obligations, knowing there are children that do not have that luxury, do not have that privilege or that honor in their lives. We can fulfill our God-given roles and responsibilities as parents and as spouses, because the expected brings peace. It brings peace to hearts and security, and they love it and they enjoy it. When a parent doesn't fulfill their responsibilities or doesn't fulfill the expected, then chaos ensues. All kinds of abuse then becomes available to that family, and it comes washing in like a flood into that family of neglect and physical and emotional and mental, and even a sexual abuse can come in if the parents are not fulfilling their roles and responsibilities for those kids. This last weekend, we had the privilege of going to Des Moines, Iowa, and I really believe this will be the last wedding that I will ever have to go back to Des Moines and perform. It's amazing. 14 and a half years later, we're still going back and doing a wedding. This young guy was born while we were there and grew up in one of the families in the church. And we knew them very, very well. He has two older sisters. I performed one of those weddings many years ago. But it was his time to get married, and he met this girl named Abby. And Abby Egli is her last name, E-G-L-I, and it was so neat. I didn't know her before. I had never met her before. We were able to meet through Zoom and do some premarital counseling for several weeks, and so I got to know her through that, and it really enjoyed getting to know her and what a delightful young woman that she is. And I'm really amazed at Travis. I'm like, Travis, you did really well. I mean, I look at you, Travis, and I look at Abby, and I'm just, my hat is off to you. I mean, she's beautiful, and dude, you really marrying up. Good for you. You've somehow pulled this off. I congratulate you. Then at the rehearsal, you know, I could look and see her family. I picked them out right away. I'm like, that's got to be her dad. That's got to be her dad in the sanctuary that seats, I don't know, 1,000 people or something. I and all these family members and all the groomsmen that are there and the bridesmaids, I'm like, that's got to be her dad. I mean, she looked just like her dad. Well, through all of the Zoom meetings and all the time getting to know Abby and spending this time thinking about their marriage, her and Travis, she never once brought up, nor did Travis bring up, what her story was. Very interesting story. So I'm talking to, at the rehearsal dinner, I'm talking to Jeff and Sandy, her parents, and they're telling me that they adopted Abby from Romania. And I'm like going, what? She looks just like you. And he goes, I know, everybody says that. It's crazy. And I said, well, Romania, I mean, that's kind of a different place to adopt from. How did this take place? And the mom says, Sandy, she says, well, in 1989, I was watching a 60 Minutes program, and that's when I decided we're going to go to Romania and adopt a baby. I'm like, what? How does that happen? I said, so you go through an adoption agency or something like that? I mean, you know, what are the costs and all that? They said, no, we didn't go through an adoption agency. We're watching 60 Minutes. There's the fall of the dictator. And they're talking about the children that are just flooding into orphanages and the poverty and the just the abject poverty and all the things that are going on there. And I told my husband, we're going to go to Romania some way and we're going to adopt a baby. So they did. They did. So they went over there. The only money they spent was for their plane tickets or travel expenses and for their court costs. But they didn't pay thousands of them. Today, if you want to adopt a baby, I don't even know if I meant to check to see if Romania is an open country. I don't think it is for adoption, but it might be. But I know some of those Eastern Bloc countries are. But I don't know about Romania. But going through an adoption agency today is $30,000 to $50,000. I mean, you can't adopt without paying a lot of money. But here they went over there, and they're staying in this rundown kind of an apartment type place in these people's home on the third floor. They said it had an elevator that worked about once a week, that it would work properly. They'd have electricity like every other day. I mean, it was just horrible, horrible conditions. And as they're looking for a baby to adopt while they're over there, they were riding in a taxi cab, and the taxi cab driver found out why they were there as Americans. And he said, oh, I know a family that may want to adopt their baby they've had that's only like a few weeks old. And so he took them to this family, introduced them, they talked to him, and this family had 7 children and this newborn baby. They made arrangements to adopt this baby. Her name was Elizabeth. And they spent, I think, a couple of trips going back and forth, but finally got a court date, which you're never sure if when you were there, when the court date was scheduled, if it was going to take place, if it was actually going to be done, but it eventually did get done. And they adopted Elizabeth, and she changed her name to Abby in America. And so here she is in Des Moines, Iowa, marrying this guy. It's absolutely amazing. And the parents of her, they had 6 other kids. 2 of the girls were like 7 or 8 years old, her sisters, but they'd already had mental issues because of malnutrition and because of the conditions that they were living in. So they'd become mentally incapable in some ways. So they were adopt this baby out of that area. And that was normal for that time and normal in those conditions. You see, what one set of parents should have done, they didn't, or they could not fulfill their roles and responsibilities of parents. So what other set of parents didn't have to do, they did fulfill that role and that responsibility. But even more than just the expected, we don't just do the expected, we need to do the unexpected. And that's what this family did, was to leave their home and go all the way across the world, adopt this child. But we can also do the unexpected like Jesus did, and Jesus continues to do in our lives. We can do something that our family doesn't see coming, this Christmas. We can surprise them in small ways, large ways, but little ways. We can spice it up. We can change it up. We can do something out of the ordinary, or in my case, we can do something out of my ordinary, your ordinary. Do something different. We can bring a smile or a laugh. The unexpected keeps them guessing, and the unexpected brings joy and it brings happiness. It is something they didn't see coming. You see, the ordinary is expected, but the extraordinary is from our own creativity of something investing in surprising our family. And they need that. You see, the world doesn't offer that. The world has nothing to give to them that offers peace. But when we fulfill the expected and the unexpected, it brings peace into our home and it overflows out of there as a powerful message to others. You think about just Christmas gifts. There's always the gifts that you expect. You know, you put on, you say, this is what I want for Christmas. So, Abby never gives any ideas. We have no idea about our Abby, our daughter. But our son is always quick to say, oh, this is what I want. This is what I want. And what he wants this year is just $175 so he can design a pair of high-top basketball shoes online and have them shipped to himself. That's what he wants, this certain kind. And Gabe Maynor has more shoes than Sandy and I and Abby put together. He has shoes everywhere. He has them in his closet. He has them on his bed. He has them under his bed. I'm like, well, what's wrong with these shoes? Why don't you wear those? Oh, no, those are autographed. I'm not using them. Why don't you wear these shoes? Oh, no, those are my outdoor court shoes. What are these? These are my indoor court shoes. Well, then what are these? Oh, it's my other outdoor court shoes. Well, what are those? That's my other indoor court shoes. You know, it's all those things. He's got shoes in his car. He's got shoes in his apartment in Mississippi. He's got shoes everywhere. And the guy wants for Christmas, it was really no surprise, he wants a pair of shoes for Christmas. But we give the Christmas gifts that they expect, but then you want to think about what they don't expect. You want to somehow surprise them with something. I love hearing those stories at Christmas time, how parents are able to surprise their kids. It may not be a big thing, or it could be a big thing, but that is what brings joy to us as parents, in being able to do that and surprise them. You know, this Christmas is how can we model peace through the expected and the unexpected? How can we bring peace into our homes and that overflow to our world of today? You know, there's an incredible prayer that I would encourage you to adopt and memorize. Romans chapter 15 and verse number 13. Paul is writing to the church at Rome that was in persecution, that was really struggling. And this was his prayer for them, this same idea. He says this, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. What a beautiful, beautiful prayer that is. So if we could take that prayer and somehow apply it to our family and to our lives, because this world is filled with so much hurt and so much hate and division and turmoil and unhappiness, our nation is, and that can easily seep into our family and into the hearts of our kids, where they don't know what is going to happen and they don't have the peace and the security. Do you have peace in your family? Is peace the story that others read in your family? You know, Christmas is a story of Jesus fulfilling the expected and also the unexpected. Peace in our hearts, peace in our homes. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that you've given us your Son, Jesus Christ. This most precious gift, this most treasured gift, Jesus Christ, the person who brings peace. The only way that peace can be established here on earth is through Messiah, Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you would inspire us this Christmas, revive us this Christmas as we think about the peace that only comes through Jesus Christ. The expected and the unexpected, may we do these things with our families. May we fulfill our roles. Give us the strength and the wherewithal to do that, but also give us the creativity to do the unexpected, to spice things up, to make our families have even more peace and security that the world does not know, that they have joy and happiness, they know true peace. Father, we're so thankful for your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray that you'd bless us now as we reflect on these words and how the Holy Spirit has dealt with us in our hearts this morning. For I pray it in his name. Amen. Would you stand, please? And let's close out this morning by singing to our Prince of Peace.
We thank you for this morning. We thank you for the King who came, God. We thank you for Jesus, Lord. Go with us this week. Lead God and direct us in all that we do. And we give you thanks and we give you praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church family, we'll see you next week.
Joyful. questions. Oh, come let us